resistance is futile.
Boldly going where no show has gone before. This is the Week in Geek with David D. Squared, your source for geek and pop culture news that's trending now. Broadcasting from the Gregory Ricks and Associates Wealth Management Studios, here's D. Squared.
Greetings, people of Earth. This is the Week in Geek, your source for geek and pop culture news that's trending now. I'm your host, D. Squared. All right, let me lay out the show for you real quick. DC Fandome happened, so we got you covered, trailers galore. And we got two, count them, two guests tonight. Bradley Garret, author of Bunker, Building for the End Times, will join us around 7:30-ish. And then, of course, New York Times bestselling author Kevin Hearne will join us. His new book, Ink and Sigil, comes out August 25th. And you'll want to check out that interview because if you pre-order the book, you can get a signed nameplate from none other than Kevin Hearne. But let's jump right into it. Not a whole lot of time to waste tonight.
And now, your top nerd news stories from around the world, brought to you by the Viridian Tea Company. Find them on Etsy. And now, your top nerd news stories.
All right, topping us off tonight, DC Fandome's been going on, and look, there's a lot to get into, and so all the things that happened up until this point right now, I'm thinking that pretty much Gotham Knights, this is the trailer that dropped was astounding, and I'm just so excited for this. This is going to be Warner Brothers Games Montreal's new open world title, because then the second game is super excited about is Suicide Squad Kill the Justice League, put out by Rocksteady Games. But here is the Gotham Knights trailer. Take a listen to this.
We're still waiting for further details.
Emergency vehicles are
outside. It appears that a large portion of the building has actually collapsed.
In international news, an explosion rocked Gotham City earlier today.
We are now able to confirm that billionaire philanthropist Bruce Wayne is.
If you're watching this, I'm dead.
This is a code black.
This message was automatically triggered when I destroyed the cave and everything it contained. We both know it won't take long for Gotham's criminals to realize the Batman is gone. And you can't count on the GCPD. They haven't trusted us since Jim died. Gotham will need its protectors more than ever. I'm leaving you the Belfry as a base of operations. Some of the technology is outdated, but it has the gear you need and all of my files. You've always had my back when I needed you. I know you'll keep Gotham safe. Good luck. And goodbye.
No one talks about them. Not a whisper word is said. For if you try to crush them, then the town strikes you dead.
All I know is that in my house, it's going to be a real fight to decide who gets to play the Red Hood. But look, you've got the Robin, you've got Nightwing, you've got the Red Hood, and then, of course, you know, you've got Batgirl. So this whole, the world and the gameplay, it was like 4-minute long trailer that I diced down, but it just smacks of like the Rocksteady games, and I'm really excited about this title coming out. And, you know, look, it's... with Suicide Squad, Kill the Justice League, which we're going to talk about in a few seconds here, the world looks so great. It's just that dark, gritty, cool look, but it's not like the wholly depressing, like I'm just going to go, you know, be sad the whole time playing this game. It just looks phenomenal, and I can't wait for this title to come out. Now, moving on over to the Suicide Squad, Kill the Justice League. Now, This trailer was hysterical. I'm kind of thankful that they didn't curse a lot. I think they did, but I bleeped it all out. But here is the Suicide Squad Kill the Justice League.
Give me a sit rep.
I've got eyes on the target.
Air support is getting cut to pieces. Where the hell are you?
I'm going in. We lost the target! Repeat! Task Force X has lost the target!
Damn it! Argus 3 is taking heavy fire! Get to Park Ridge ASAP!
Don't worry, boss. We got this. Hey! Boomer! Lay down suppressant fire!
Keep it down, Hal. These are still ringing after that last Bonnie.
What is that? Australian for hangover?
I believe I can translate. Boomerang has a concussion from the enemy you missed in our last encounter.
Guess those teeth are sharper than your eyes, Shark Man. I never
miss. Never miss.
Never miss. Yeah, yeah, we bloody know. You never shut up about it.
Task Force X. Alpha target is in the open. Get your asses to the Metropolis Grand Hotel and engage. Before I have another reason to blow those bombs in your heads.
Yeah, it's double national underground. I'm gonna knock off the ground. Like a man in hell, I take the silver back. I'm ready to change. Can't stop a train. Who wants to talk? Don't come unprepared. I'll be there, but when I leave there, I'm gonna get out the lane.
Well, that should knock a few years off the old sentence.
That's reminding me of something. Oh, yeah! Waller's stupid alpha target. Who are we supposed to be killing again?
Whoa. Look, it's Superman. The mighty Superman has just rescued that pilot.
What a show-off. Beat it, Spandex! We're on a top-secret assassination mission here!
Uh-oh.
No.
Quarterback is toast.
So, figure out who we're killing yet?
Superman.
Oh, fuck! I shouldn't have done that shot.
This trailer was so phenomenal, man. It opens up with a Brainiac ship crash down. And so, obviously, you've got the Justice League who are under the control of Brainiac and, you know, kill the poor helicopter. I love King Shark where he's like, look, it's Superman. He saved that man. He reminded me like Drax the Destroyer from the Marvel Universe. But the gameplay looks phenomenal where, you know, that you've got the whole Arkham engine that Rocksteady has. So that this game just looks so great to play on top of the fact that it looks really funny. And I already like the way the characters are sort of gelling. You know, it's going to be better than Suicide Squad, the movie. But what a segue. That leads me into Suicide Squad 2, the trailer that dropped for that. I guess not really a trailer. It's James Gunn and a lot of the cast. And then you kind of find out about all the people who are going to be in this movie. So here, take a listen to the Suicide Squad. I guess behind-the-scenes sort of thing with Dujabi.
It's going to be different from any superhero movie ever made.
There's no one better in the world to direct the Suicide Squad than James Gunn.
I was excited with an opportunity to be able to do the Suicide Squad in the way it could be done from my point of view.
This one is completely unique. This is a gritty 1970s war movie combined with the brilliance of James Gunn's characters and comedy.
You need your director to set the vibe.
The Suicide Squad is just a twisted fantasy of characters.
Within each of our characters, there's a certain beauty. Within most of them. Some of them are just pretty crappy through and through.
Be like a douchey Captain America.
The guy who believes in peace at any cost, no matter how many people he needs to kill along the way.
Okay, I got it.
Don't ever settle back like you think you know where this is going, because you don't.
As soon as you have some sense about what's about to happen next, James comes in.
Boom!
one is exploding. Genitals, heads, arms, legs.
It's like a big, massive graphic novel brought to life.
This is by far the biggest movie I've ever made.
I don't think that you know what to expect.
Don't get too attached.
This has been truly the greatest, most exciting journey of my life, making this film. Cut. That was great.
This was the Suicide Squad movie we wanted in the first place. This is the one we wanted instead of that craptacular festival of badness that we got in the first one. You've already got a massive cast of characters. Before I even go through the actors and the people they're going to be playing, just when you look at what this film is with the larger cast, it lends itself to putting maybe a little bit of mystery as to which Suicide Squad members are going to either die or get their heads blown off, because you knew who was going to get thrown away in the first one because they didn't waste much time on explaining who he was. I mean, that movie was just terrible. It was just terrible. Now, this one looks like it's going to be something, a bit of an epic movie. And just looking at the cast of characters, you got Idris Elba playing Bloodsport. Now, you've got a bunch of characters that James Gunn actually created for this, like Alice Bragg is going to be playing Solsoria. And then Nathan Fillion playing TDK. People are thinking that maybe it's a knockoff from a knockout, a female villain with super strength. But then you got Pete Davidson playing Blackguard, who's, well, he's a dumbass. And Pete Davidson is too. But Michael Rooker pops up playing Savant. Now, this is Michael Rooker. What more can you say, man? I got to interview this guy like 3 years ago. He is just so cool. And he does bad guys really, really well. He even did a good guy in Guardians of the Galaxy. So I guess his tenure with Marvel is over, and now he's jumped over to DC. I'm curious if he survives. I doubt he will, because you've got such a long list of people. They're going to be dying left and right, just like they said in the little trailer, don't get too attached. Well, duh. It's called Suicide Squad. Reminds me of that old comic book Strike Force Moratori. We who are about to die, they get superpowers, and then that's clock starts ticking, they die. But yet I digress. All right, Michael Rooker. Then John Cena playing Peacemaker, who he's quoted as saying a douchey sort of Captain America. That gun is so stupid. He really looks like a bad wrestler costume that he's wearing in that trailer. David Dismalchian playing Polka Dot Man. He looks like Wonder Bread. But I love how they're bringing some of these nobody characters, because then you got Peter Capaldi, who's going to be playing, where is it? There he is, the Thinker, Flula Borg. That was the guy who was saying people are blowing up their genitals everywhere. He's playing Javelin. And then you got Daniela Melchior, the Ratcatcher 2, and then Mailing Ning as Mongol. Look, man, all I can say about this movie is that right now it looks like the movie we probably should have got in the first one. But all these things just started falling apart in the DCEU because they couldn't get everybody to work on the same page. And that kind of lends itself to the thing we're going to be talking about on the other side of this break, because you've got the Zack Snyder cut that's going to be coming out. We'll talk a little bit about that. I didn't bother with the trailer because if you've already seen the movie, there wasn't a whole lot of new stuff to be wowed about in that one. But we'll be talking about that on the other side of this break. Stick around, guys. When we come back, we'll continue our conversation about DC Fandome. And of course, the Batman trailer that came out as well. We'll talk about that. Him taking on the Riddler. This is The Week in Geek on News Talk 99.5 WRNO.
Hello, wonderful friends. It is I, Starfire of Tamaran, here to tell you you are listening to The Week in Geek on the radio. This is the radio, yes?
Welcome back into The Week in Geek, your source for geek and pop culture news that's trending now. I'm your host, D Squared. I gave Scungy the night off because we got two, count them, two interviews coming up after this segment. We'll talk with Bradley Garret, author of Bunker, Building for the End Times. And then we'll wrap up tonight's show with New York Times bestselling author Kevin Hearne of the Iron Druid Chronicles. His latest book, Ink and Sigil, comes out August 25th. That's Tuesday. So let's keep on rolling on with DC Fandome news that's been breaking. Yesterday was a very busy day. We got more stuff coming out today, but I had to pre-record this segment because there are two, count them two, hurricanes barreling down on us, Marco and Polo. Marco and Laura, you get the joke. It's terrible, I know. All right, so let's talk about the Batman trailer that came out. The Batman, look, there was some, I don't know what, you know, Robert Pattinson's a weird kind of dude. And then he said Batman is not a superhero, but he wears a cape. All right, so shut up. But here's the trailer and take a listen.
From your secret friend, having a clue. Let's play a game, just me and you. Any of this mean anything to you?
If you are justice, please do not lie. What is the price for your blind eye?
The hell are you supposed to be?
That scene is what I think sold me on it.
I'm vengeance.
I'm vengeance. I am the knight.
You're part of this too. How am I part of it? You'll see.
So I kind of talked over part of the trailer when after he beats the snot out of that little hoodlum, he's in some sort of car chase in the new Batmobile. And this guy's like, this guy's crazy. And it reminds me of Michael Keaton's Batman. Who are you? It sounds almost just like him. Who are you? I'm the Batman. I am vengeance. When he just beats the snot out of that dude, that's when the trailer changed for me. I was like, you know what? I kind of dig this. So look, it's taken place in year two of the Batman. So it's not like an origin story per se. That's according to Matt Reeves, the director and the writer. And some of the cooler things you see in there, obviously he's going to be fighting the Riddler. But then you got Zoe Kravitz who pops up as a Catwoman. And then you got the Penguin, Colin Farrell showing his face. I was initially sort of concerned that this movie might not be so hot, but the trailer has sort of changed my mind. I'm still not a big, you know, fan of Robert Pattinson, but this looks pretty good. I'm pleasantly surprised at the trailer, and so I am more enthusiastic about this movie as it comes along. All right, the other big trailer to drop yesterday was Wonder Woman. That sort of kind of kicked off the whole shebang yesterday. And, okay, let me just say that I think that, you know, Wonder Woman 84 should be a good movie, but the trailer did the opposite for me. Now I am concerned about this movie, but here, take a listen.
This world is not yet ready for all that you will do. Your time will come, Diana. And everything will be different.
Citizens of the world,
I'm here to change your life.
Anything you want, anything you dream of, you can have it.
You look like you saw a ghost. Diana, lucky you. It's like not one day has passed.
I don't want to be like anyone. I want to be an apex predator. You've always had everything, while people like me have had nothing. Well, now it's my turn. get used to it.
The way I fly, they will never find us.
I forgot to tell you.
What?
Radar.
Will they shoot at us?
Barbara, what did you do?
Rawr, now she looks like a cheetah.
You know, I'm not so keen on this one. I figure you are, but you know what? I'm ready to go.
I think we can do better.
Got a fanny pack.
Parachute pants?
Yeah.
Does everybody parachute now?
Oh, dear God. All right, Chris Pine. Yeah, I can totally do without him in this movie right now. It's just, and he just sounds the same. Does everybody parachute now? Are they going to shoot at us? All right, what? The anachronistic man from the past. This is going to be the worst part of the movie, I predict right now. That it's just, he's going to be some sort of comic relief, and it's just going to be dumb and fall flat. This is my opinion. I could be wrong, but what they're showing in this trailer gives me cause for concern that they're going to waste valuable time on trying to make this movie funnier by making these stupid little, things. I don't know. That makes me concerned. I'll just say that right now. Now, Kristen Wiig, when she shows up in the movie as well, when I first saw her, I just thought she was some sort of common streetwalker from Chefman Tour Highway or Airline Highway. You know the kinds. So I was like, what the hell is going on here? Is this her costume? Did she just like go to the thrift store and find everything that had cheetah print on it? But then, fortunately, they give us the animalistic version of her, which that looked pretty cool. I'm more interested to see the fight between Wonder Woman and Cheetah than I am about really anything else. The guy, attention citizens of the world, just I don't know. I know they're trying to, you know, build off a very successful first movie, and it looks like they're going to have little nuggets of Diana and, you know, Wonder Woman's importance to the world in general. But, you know, with the whole DCEU just kind of crumbling apart, I'm a little concerned about that. So I'm more concerned about Wonder Woman 84 than I am about the Batman now, and that says a lot. Maybe I'm wrong. Hopefully I'm wrong, because I don't want to poo-poo on these movies, because Wonder Woman's been the only one that's really been worth the damn in the DCEU, because moving on to the Snyder Cut, we're finally going to get the Snyder Cut. Yay. And it's going to be a four-hour extravagant. What is this, Roots? What? 4 hours? No wonder. I just, oh man. So we're going to get the super duper secret purple Power Ranger double blind nil version of like the Blade Runner super director cut of Zack Snyder's cut of Justice League. Okay. It's basically going to be a different movie. And I think we all can agree that Justice League sucked on rocks. I mean, it was just a god awful movie. Now, this one, you know, look, Zack Snyder's vision was obviously corrupted when, the passing of his daughter forced him to step away. And, you know, God, my heart goes out to him as a parent. Obviously, you know, you have to step away when something that tragic happens. And Joss Whedon stepped in, but all the remakes made it a horrible movie. Now, is this movie going to be any better? You've got Apocalypse, L-I-P-S. And the other thing is, and Cyborg, his character was supposed to have a more important role. We heard a lot about that after the fact, and there was some mud being slung between him and Joss Whedon. And it appears that in this new 4-hour Zack Snyder extravaganza supercut, that you're going to see more of what the movie was maybe envisioned from Zack Snyder's view, where Cyborg was the heart of the team and he was the guy who brought them all together, per se, as a team. And you're going to get more from Ezra Miller, that he made this weird little thing about Flash and the time continuum. So I'm wondering how that's going to sort of play into all of this. And by the way, did we uncancel Ezra Miller? Didn't he punch a woman in the face? So how has he still got a job? Whatever. You know, I leave that up to you fine folks out there to decide amongst yourself. Talk amongst yourselves. It's like butter. But the Zack Snyder cut, 4 hours. It'll be a different movie. Is it a 4-hour movie? I don't know. I mean, dear God. But it'll be different. You know, it'll probably be the Vision that was supposed to be the movie that we didn't get. And we got that, you know, turd burger on toast. So, yay. I'm not so psyched up as everybody else is losing their damn mind about it, where it's just like, oh my God, the Zack Snyder cut's here. You know, tip of the cap to the super fans that were able to get this done. You know, so hey, that's great, but you can't rewrite history. You're not the Flash. You can't go back in time and make people suddenly decide, you know what? That's it. I don't foresee this Snyder cut rebooting the DCEU. I see Suicide Squad 2 maybe rebooting and putting a little vim and vigor back into the DCEU. Maybe they can build off of that. And maybe Wonder Woman 84 will not be just a bunch of stupid time jokes with Chris Pine sounding the same. Are they going to shoot at us? My big takeaway from DC Fandome right now is that they're on the right path. That DC is forging a new path through the video games and some of their big screen offerings that maybe DCEU will get back on track. That's my hope. That is what I'm looking forward to. I think there might be a couple of stinkers here and there in between, but at the end of the day, I am looking forward to what DC is offering us. All right, so let's wrap up this segment. Coming up next, Bradley Garrett, author of Bunker, Building for the End Times. He'll join us. And then right after that, we will have Kevin Hearne, author of the Iron Druid Chronicles, Ink and Sigil. Hits newsstands August 25th. You'll want to listen to that. And as always, we strongly urge you to check out the Facebook page, facebook.com/TheWeekInGeek. Check out our website at twigradio.com. Follow us on Twitter at twigradio and the Instagram's TheWeekInGeek. And of course, you can download the podcast on the free iHeartRadio app, Spreaker.com, Apple, Stitcher, Spotify, you name it. We got you covered. This is The Week in Geek on News Talk 99.5 WRNO.
This is The Week in Geek, your source for geek and pop culture news that's trending now. Like them on Facebook and follow them on Twitter at Twig Radio. Do it now.
Welcome back into The Week in Geek, your source for geek and pop culture news that's trending now. I'm your host, D Squared. Let's go to the guest line. Joining me tonight, Bradley Garrett, author of Bunker, Building for the End Times, joins us tonight. Bradley, how are you tonight?
I'm great, D-Square. Good to be with you, man.
Absolutely. Dude, look, all right, I'm entranced by this book. I'm entranced by the whole prep culture. There was an old series on A&E called The Colony, which was basically people that didn't prep, and they had to do a whole, you know, try to survive the apocalypse scenario. But tell me about your book, Bunker, Building for the End Times.
Well, I've spent the past 3 years following preppers around, chatting with them, seeing what they've been building, seeing what they've been stockpiling. And of course, talking to them about what they think the disaster is that may be ahead of us. When I started working on the book in 2017, of course, I had no idea it would be published in the middle of a pandemic. But there are some eerily prescient quotes in there where people were telling me in 2019 that we were overdue for a pandemic and it was just around the corner. So I can't say I was surprised when it hit, but what I would say to everyone is that based on the 3 years of research that I've done, the thing that has become really clear to me is that disaster is a part of our lives, and we should all be thinking more about building up our own resiliency to be able to deal with stuff like this.
So, Bradley, tell me, the book, is it more just kind of like a snapshot of preppers, or is this more like a commentary on the times? Because I know a lot of us sometimes consider, you know, what the future holds for us, and sometimes, like, for preppers, it's like a mix of hope and despair, because, you know, you're preparing for something horrible to happen, but then you're trying to build something so you can survive and move into the future to build something again. But, like what is the thought process behind it, the book?
Well, yeah, I mean, you're right. The book is both things. It's a story about culture. You know, it's a story about people who are building communities. It's also a story about the people who are making an absolute fortune selling us the antidote to our anxieties. I call these people in the book the dread merchants, you know, the people that are selling bunkers and freeze-dried food and assault vehicles and right. armor kits for cars. It's a huge industry. But at the same time, you know, this industry exists because people have hope in the future, right? If you don't believe that that there's going to be a future, you wouldn't prep for it.
Right.
And a lot of what people are trying to find, I think, is a sense of community. And you know, a lot of us have lost that in recent decades. You know, people, particularly people who live in the suburbs, for instance, you know, they don't know their neighbors. They haven't worked through plans. You know, we're all busy, overworked, overtired. It's hard to think about building community, and particularly building a community that we can depend on in bad times. But that's precisely what these preppers are doing. So it is a snapshot of the contemporary United States, but it's a snapshot around the world of how you know our declining influence is leading to people thinking more about self-sufficiency.
Well, that rolls into my next question. We're visiting with Bradley Garret, author of Bunker, Building for the End Times. So you've got this big survival condo, which is a converted missile silo that's deep, deep into the earth. And when you get there, apparently like the first level, they've got like a grocery store and there's theaters. And then the residential levels are all the way on the bottom. But this is for the fancy pants people. But they're also building things over in New Zealand across the country. And you've been to so many of these places, because I was reading up on you that you might have gotten in trouble with the law a few times by sneaking into some places you shouldn't have been, which I think is really awesome. Good job, sir.
Thank you. Yeah. I spend a lot of my time doing research on topics that are really challenging, you know, trying to get access to communities and places that where I'm not supposed to be, or with people who don't necessarily want me there. I don't know why those topics attract me. I guess it's the challenge. Yeah, I you know, once I started traveling the world to see these bunker communities, I realized that it was just there was so much there. It was so rich. And the way that people were prepping in different countries, you know, it varied. So in Israel, for instance, people, when you build a new house, you have to have a hardened room inside the house with no windows. It's essentially a blast shelter.
Wow.
In case there's a kind of, you know, rogue missile that gets fired into your building. And these rooms are called mamads. And people go to great lengths to kind of disguise the mamad, you know, turning them into offices or nurseries. You know, trying to make sure that it doesn't look like a blast room. But you know, once you start seeing this kind of hardened architecture for dealing with disaster, you start seeing it everywhere. And that was so fascinating to me as a researcher, to be able to dig into those spaces and kind of reveal the hidden in the world.
And so, Bradley, I guess, you know, it's like this is something that's kind of ingrained into human beings, because like there are centuries old bunkers that people dug into caverns and cave systems to sort of create them and prepare themselves from either the Mongol horde or whatever, you know, big nasty might be coming down the road. So this is something that we've been doing pretty much the entirety of human existence.
Yeah, it's very much a human trait to think about the future and to prepare for it. I mean, I guess, you know, maybe bears going into hibernation are I don't know if that's instinct or anticipation. But the way that human beings stockpile is unique to us. And as soon as you settle down, as soon as you stop and stay in one place, you have to start thinking about stockpiling, particularly if you're in a place where you've got harsh winters, right? You've got to have your stockpile in place to make it through those times. But, you know, once you start worrying about social unrest and people taking your stuff, and you worry about natural disasters after you've been through a few of them, you know, that awareness of our mortality is what drives us to build bunkers and defensible space, what drives us to prepare. And I just find it absolutely fascinating that that we've been doing this for almost all of human history, and that's part of why we're still surviving despite everything.
Well, you know, one of my favorite games is Fallout games by Bethesda, and I'm a giant nerd. I've played D&D most of my life, and we've kind of like role-played through a lot of these scenarios through other role-playing games as what the apocalypse might look like. But I am kind of partial to the Fallout thing because I don't have enough money to build a bunker, so I'm kind of hoping I'll survive whatever Holocaust happens, and then I could just run around listening to old-time music and, you know, fighting mutant monsters. It'd be awesome, man.
You know, it's kind of interesting that we have this huge appetite for post-apocalyptic novels and video games and films before the pandemic.
Right,
and,
right.
And I think part of it was a kind of fantasy, right? Like, you know, people feel frustrated, like they have a lack of control, the world feels like it's falling apart. And so there was almost a desire to know what would happen if we just hit the reset button. You know, what does the post-apocalyptic world look like? And so we played out those fantasies. But of course, now that we're in the midst of a terrible disaster, they don't seem so appealing anymore to a lot of people, I think.
You are correct. That is Bradley Garret, author of Bunker Building for the End Times. Bradley, where can people get your book and on Twitter, your goblin merchant?
That's a Warcraft reference.
Oh, God, it is!
The original Warcraft, not World of Warcraft. But that's the goblin merchant that you buy your potions from.
Anyway,
you can find me at bradleygarret.com, goblin merchant on social media. Get the book on Amazon, Barnes & Noble, wherever. It's easy to find, and so am I. Reach out.
All right, Bradley, thank you so much for your time tonight. I really appreciate it, man.
Hey, thank you.
That was Bradley Garret, author of Bunker, Building for the End Times. Just seems appropriate to go out with Fallout music as we go to break. You know, I didn't even get to talk to him about how William Shatner actually owns a missile silo that he converted into a research facility to see if there was viability for colonizing Mars. I didn't realize Star Trek made that much bank, so good on the Shat. All right, this is The Week in Geek on News Talk, 99.5 WRNO.
Atom bomb, baby, loaded with power, radioactive as a TV tower.
Hey, Dad, this is Pinky of Pinky and the Brain. And when Brain and I are not planning to take over the world, which is pretty much never, but when that happens, the only show we listen to, or rather the only show Brain allows me to listen to, is The Week in Geek on WRNO. Lord.
Welcome back into The Week in Geek, your source for geek and pop culture news that's trending now. I'm your host, D Squared. Let's go to the guest line, man. We have New York Times best-selling author joining us tonight, Kevin Hearne. Kevin, how the hell are you, bud?
Oh, I'm doing pretty great. As far as anybody can be doing great in these times, I'm doing okay.
Look, the pandemic has been, interesting to say the least, but one of the good things to sort of come out of this pandemic is a lot of more creativity. Authors and creators, comic books and artists, et cetera, just been like putting their nose to the grindstone and cranking out some stuff. But we brought you on tonight to talk about your new book, which is coming out August 25th, Ink and Sigil. You had a chance to talk to my co-host about, it was like February. It was February of this year, and you were teasing Ink and Sigil and the new magic that you've created with the sigil and the runes.
Yeah, they're just called sigils, and they're made with magical inks. And so if you don't have the magical ink or you don't draw the sigil correctly with said ink, nothing happens. You just doodled something. But, if you get the right combination of ink and sigil, then great stuff happens. And that's a large part of the fun here. It's based on druidic stuff from my Iron Druid Chronicles, but they don't have to be druids. So they're kind of creating very temporary druidic bindings with this magic. And that way they don't have to actually be full druids. And the idea was that Briad made the sigil agents to enforce some things, magical contracts, since the Iron Druid couldn't get things done. So that's where this is coming from. That's the spin-off part of it, and it's also a slightly different focus, more mystery-based, and it's a lot of fun for me.
Well, you know, and it's interesting that McVarish, Aloysius Al McVarish, he is your protagonist, but he made an appearance in Besieged in earlier during the Iron Druid Chronicles. What was it about this character that made you want to kind of dig into it and do more with him?
Well, yeah, he was sort of this walk-on, almost throwaway character in a short story I did for Besieged. But the more I thought about him, the more I was curious about why was he there and what was his connection? Like, he seemed to know everybody, and, you know, why would that be? And yeah, so the more I thought about it, the more the whole backstory started to come to me, and I started becoming interested in what kind of adventures he would be doing on his own when he wasn't appearing in somebody else's story. So that's kind of the genesis of the whole thing. I did not expect it to be so honking fun as it's turned out to be. I actually got to go to Scotland and, you know, do some location scouting and learn so much about Glasgow and how wonderful a city it is. And yeah, I hope everybody enjoys it, because I've had just a blast reading or writing it.
We're visiting with Kevin Hearne, New York Times bestselling author of the Iron Druid Chronicles. Now, also, Ink and Sigil coming out August 25th. What is it just about the druidic things that speaks to you, I guess? What is it that you love that storytelling aspect and that history?
Well, I think a lot of the, you know, it's kind of based around a lot of Irish paganism, which doesn't get a ton of attention in terms of the world's mythologies. It's a little bit different from the rest of them, since they did have interaction with a lot of the ancient worlds, but they were also, you know, they also enjoyed a little bit of isolation. So they are... They're a little bit different in some of the particulars, and I really kind of enjoy that about them. One of the things that's really kind of interesting about Irish paganism is that women didn't have really any sort of a subservient role. They were, you know, equals in every sense, and a lot of the goddesses were actually running the show, and nobody had difficulty with that. So it's only later on that you see the patriarchy get established in Ireland. So I really enjoyed that aspect of it. And some of the other little details, like their love god was really not into love so much, you know, just really unexpected things. So that's kind of what drew me to it. And a lot of the Scottish fairy stuff is very closely related. There's a lot of overlap with the Irish. So it seemed like a natural way to go. And of course, you know, my location scouting, my visits to Scotland were just delightful. Glasgow is completely goth. You know, they've got that cathedral and that necropolis, you know, just right. Acres and acres and acres of a hilly cemetery. So I really loved it. It was wonderful.
So it's all just a ploy for you to just travel the world. That's what is going on right here, Kevin.
Yeah, that's right. It's all I get to travel and write it off as taxes because of research, right? So.
So have you watched Cursed, the Netflix series? Have you watched Cursed yet?
Oh, no, I haven't. Is it good?
Yes. Look, I honestly thought you would have watched it, because it takes in the fae and the druid magic, and it's the King Arthur sort of things. But instead, Nimue, who is a sky person who speaks to the old gods of the hidden, is chosen by Excalibur, but they haven't named it Excalibur yet. But it's like a Vorpal weapon. It kicks ass, and she kicks ass, and it's a 10... episode run, an hour a piece, like 45 minutes or so. I'm episode 5 in it right now, and I'm just hooked, man. And it's a really cool take on the Arthurian legends, but from the druidic angle. So I think this is right in your wheelhouse, bud.
Oh, okay. Well, I'll have to check it out. Thanks for letting me know.
So Kevin Hearne is our guest, New York Times bestselling author. Ink and Sigil comes out August 25th. Now, you are doing some signed book plates. How can people get some of these signed book plates from you with the new Ink and Sigil book?
Oh, yeah. Well, if they pre-order, and time is running out on that because, you know, the pre-orders end on the day of the release on August 25th. But if you pre-order any copy of the book, I don't care if it's hardcover, ebook, or audiobook, and you can pre-order it from any bookstore you want, it doesn't matter, then if you let me know, you take like a screenshot of your order and email that to me along with a shipping address, I will send you a signed book plate. And there are, I should mention that there are 4 particular indie bookstores in the United States that already have signed book plates, and so if you order from them, they will ship you one with it inside, ready to go. And that's the Poisoned Pen in Arizona, Malaprops in North Carolina, Fountain Bookstore in Virginia, and also Mysterious Galaxy in San Diego.
Nice. So can people get some of that from like your website, or can they follow you on Twitter? What's the best way to try to get that information?
Yeah, there's on my website, if they go to my blog, which is called Writer's Grove, there's basically an article there detailing how to get that. But and then emailing is, you know, emailing me basically is the key with your screenshot of your order. And you could just email info@kevinhearne.com, and I will get a book plate in the mail for you.
So Ink and Sigil comes out on the 25th, and I was checking out your Twitter feed, so apparently you've already put in the manuscript for Paper and Blood. Now, when can we expect that book to pop up? And who's in it? Are we gonna see Oberon and Atticus again?
Yeah, actually, yes. Atticus, Oberon, Starbuck have a pretty big role to play in Paper and Blood, because that particular adventure takes them down to Australia, where we last saw Atticus, Oberon, and Starbuck. So they get into all kinds of shenanigans down there. I don't know exactly when it is going to be out, except that I could say just in general next year, because I just now turned it in yesterday to my editor. So we still have to go through edits and things like that. But and I haven't been given a publication date, but it'll be coming soon, and I'll be announcing it on my social media when I do have it, for sure.
New York Times bestselling author Kevin Hearne is our guest. Talk to me about Wizards and Wordsmith and the Dungeons and Dragons, dude. Talk to me.
Oh, wow. Okay, so you heard about that. That's
I
cool.
Did.
Jim Zub is the Dungeon Master, along with me and four other authors. We basically had a Dungeons and Dragons adventure where we were all part of the Guild of Gastronomy. And I played a hill dwarf named Keggy Gruntled. And I had a specialty of being a condiment sommelier. And, you know, we deploy all kinds of fun little, you know, food-based weaponry against our enemies. And it's a blast. Just really kind of fun and creative stuff going on when you get four authors in the room and they're allowed to improvise. So, yeah, that'll be playing online here very soon as part of Del Rey's Book Your Summer Live, I believe it's called. And I think if you go to that, bookyoursummerlive.com, you could just kind of sign up. You could follow along virtually and enjoy the adventures and the various panels and things that will be going on there.
That is Kevin Hearne, New York Times bestselling author. Ink and Sigil hits the bookshelves August 25th. And if you pre-order now, you can get a signed book plate. Kevin, once again, tell the folks where they can get more information, follow you on social media, all that jazz, brother.
Well, my website is kevinhearne.com. And then I'm also on Twitter and Instagram @KevinHearne, all one word. So pretty easy to find, hopefully. And please feel free to shout out to me, and thank you guys so much for reading. I really appreciate it.
So, look, thank you so much. I really appreciate your time today. It was great talking to you, man.
Oh, it was great talking to you, too. Take care of yourself. Yes, thank you so much.
All right, that's going to do it for tonight's show. I want to thank our guest today, Bradley Garret of Bunker, Building for the End Times. And, of course, we just wrapped up with Kevin Hearne. Look, everybody out there on the Gulf Coast, be safe. We're getting the 1-2 punch from Marco and Polo. I mean, Marco and Laura. Just hunker down, and if you see Jim Cantore in your neighborhood, run. Run like hell. As always, follow us on Twitter @TwigRadio. Instagram's The Week in Geek. And, of course, like us on Facebook, facebook.com/TheWeekInGeek. We'll be back next week. Stay safe out there. Till next time, keep your nerd flag raised high. 'Cause I'll-